like three of my mic cords.
Brendan Gleeson does.
He still, he wanders off.
That's funny. Does that, is that all right with you?
Yes, it's fine.
It's great.
And yeah, Donald's like, yep, that's Dad.
Yeah, I'm working with it. I'm working with Donald at the moment.
Sweetest guy.
He's the best.
So, I first saw you in at Sundance in the Eccles with Son of Rambo.
Wow, man.
Which is still one of my favorite films. You were a little bit smaller back then.
Thank you. It was officially half the size, yeah.
Were you a kid actor, or were you, is that situation where you kind of just got into it and you figured it out, or?
It's weird, like, I mean, as soon as that movie happened, I was sort of labeled a child actor, which was only kind of funny to me because I didn't see myself as professional or an actor until kind of much later on. So, you know, I was very grateful for that experience. I truly did not know what I was doing. I had the best experience of my life. It was the most wonderful 8 weeks, you know, I could have imagined as a 12-year-old kid running around making a movie about making a movie, you know, in the English countryside. It was incredible. And I think it did make me realize, you know, what I wanted to do. And I sort of feel like, as cheesy as it sounds, I kind of found my calling. I was a pretty unhappy kid at school and wasn't good at anything. So to have that escape route, you know, without making my school sound like a prison, which it wasn't, I was just able to, you know, reaffirm my passion for drama and performing that, you know, the school did a wonderful job of kind of fostering. And, you know, it gave me a kind of sense that, you know, beyond the school walls, there was something where, you know, I had a kind of purpose and I could, you know, contribute and also gain from life.
So did you start taking it more seriously at that point, or?
I think it's the thing that I always applied myself most to was performance. You know, I gave it my all, and I felt it was a very emotionally engaging experience. Like, I was always a very kind of like sensitive kid. I was like, you know, it was easy to make me cry, or it was easy to, you know, get me excited. You know, I kind of experienced extremes of emotions, you know, from a very early age. So I don't think, yeah, I don't think it was surprising to anyone that I kind of, you know, pursued this career, but I always took it as seriously as possible.
So it was a career from pretty early on? It felt like a career?
Yeah, I mean, as I say, I didn't feel professional. I didn't feel like a realistic career until later on. But
how far later?
I don't know, man. I guess when I pulled out of education, I guess when I removed myself from university, I was probably, that was around about the time of the first Maze Runner. And then I was like, oh, wow, this might actually be my job. That's crazy, you know. And it was following We're the Millers. And then We're the Millers came out. And that, I suppose, was a little bit of a turning point for me career-wise, just in terms of trying to make an impression in the States because, you know, for whatever reason, I think just because, you know, the American media is so dominant, you know, that felt like a milestone. So I was very grateful for that opportunity. And, you know, I got to thank New Line and Warner Brothers because they took a chance on a random English kid, you know.
Well, you weren't that random.
Well, fairly random.
Were you?
Definitely English.
Definitely English. Well, that's one of the weird, funny things about Detroit is that which took me a minute to realize was how many British actors there were in this movie.
Right, I believe there's...
Considering it's Detroit.
Yeah, there's three of us, I think.
Yeah, yeah, but like three key characters.
Right, right.
Out of, yeah, you know, the 12 characters or whatever it is.
Right, right.
Surprising in a way.
Yeah, I mean, to an extent. Although I think, you know, of the non-Americans in the principal cast, you know, you have Hannah Murray, who's British, you have myself, who's British, you have John, who's British, you have Ben O'Toole, who's Irish, and you have Jack Rayner, who's, Ben O'Toole, who's Australian, Jack Rayner, who's Irish. Huh. And, you know, I think being from Britain and without speaking for anyone, I think, you know, in Ireland and Australia, you know, the concept of racism is far from foreign, and we all have our kind of painful racial histories. You know, the white role is, you know, very much present in all of those histories. And it was important for all of us to educate ourselves on that. And I think we're all grateful to be part of something that is aimed at improving race relations and addressing a global issue, you know, of racism. You know, the American colleagues, you know, that I work with, were incredibly kind of welcoming of us being part of telling this story. And it was a very united cast bond, and I think I'm just grateful that we had a chance, you know, to be part of telling the story.
So how did you just get to go through a regular audition process to get in, or?
It was pretty irregular as an audition process. It was 3 months, lots of ups and downs, including chemistry reads and table reads and tapings and meetings and phone calls, and you know, it was a pretty stressful 3 months, but I was so grateful at the end of the trial period, as we kind of call it, to get the role.
What do you think they were trying to figure out?
It's a good question. I don't know. They may still regret the decision. I don't know.
No, I don't think so.
it's too late. I can't be edited out, I guess.
Well, did he change as you went through this process, the character?
Krause. Maybe, yeah. Yeah, I think sometimes, you know, I think it disturbed me more than I was expecting. You know, I think it was quite emotionally affecting, you know. Mm-hmm. And I'm always reluctant to talk about how emotionally affecting it was for me, because for the victims, you know, in this case, for the actors playing the victims, and of course the real people that the story is focused on, you know, it must have been, I mean, immeasurably horrific. But it was, yeah, you take it home with you a little bit, you know, not the racist mentality, but the sort of guilt and the kind of just emotion of it sometimes. Yeah, I was glad to wash myself of the character by the end of it. That was the easiest dismissal of a character I ever had, because I was never truly bonded with that character. I was just trying to inhabit him as truthfully as possible. And then, you know, given the first opportunity at the wrap of the film, you know, once we were done, I just took it off like it was a jumper on a hot day, you know. I was just like, get rid of that.
Was it scary to get into being the villain and to be somebody who is that obviously racist and obviously willing to kill?
I think racists who are as blatant as that are maybe not as frequent today, but make no mistake about it, there are people who are covertly as racist, and I think you know, systematic racism is still very unfortunately a reality, and continues to oppress people of color and deny them of social justice. So that was really what we were trying to shed light on, and my responsibility was to expose this racist individual as accurately as I possibly could, and point to the fact that, okay, you might not see Officer Krause walking down the street every day, but there are a handful of people operating in society who still cause the same sort of damage, and we need to be aware of that, and we can't become desensitized to it. It's so important that, you know, just because this has been happening historically and systematically for so long to people of color, that we don't become desensitized to it. To become desensitized is to lose our sense of humanity. You know, it's in human nature to be sensitive. So we need to remain as empathetic and as heartbroken by these sorts of events as we possibly can, and ensure that we're taking measures to avoid it happening and being a part of our future.
Well, you also have to give that guy, though, some, you know, his humanity in the course of the movie. I mean, it doesn't really work if he's just the villain.
Yeah, and I wasn't interested in having anyone empathize with Krause, to be quite honest with you. I appreciate that the role of a police officer is difficult, but in this case, I didn't want anyone to empathize with him, but I did want them to recognize him as human, because he had to be a realistic and identifiable character in society. You know, if he was just this cosmic force of evil that landed in this motel and, you know, caused these kind of unthinkable, you know, crimes to happen, then I feel like it would have been a very different comment on not only what happened, but on society today.
Well, that line of crossing over, I mean, I think maybe the most obvious example of in the picture is the you know, I don't remember what it was called in the picture, but the killing game where they're not killing the guy, but they're pretending they killed somebody to get other people to do something else. And then when it comes down to killing somebody, it seems just as easy. I mean, there's a weird, there's a humanity to choosing not to kill people, and then there's this the switch is very close, you know. It's, that's the one of the scarier things in the picture, I think.
Yeah, I think it speaks to the kind of historic trend of dehumanization when we talk about, you know, people of color and African American, you know, people in particular when talking about this story. You know, Krauss has several lines that you could interpret as being kind of empathetic. You know, he says, you know, these people look to us for law and order, and we keep letting them down left, right, and center. You might think that, you know, speaking about a community which at the time was 40% African American, you might think that he's including African American people in that comment, whereas I always read that as he's talking about white people. And in fact, he's not truly, I think, unnerved by the sight of Aubrey Pollard dead in front of him, having just been shot by Demons, Jack Rayner's character. He is panicked and upset by that because this could incriminate him. So it's a selfish, you know, preservation of white supremacy and white life. And that's the way I saw it, because in the context of a racist, you know, mindset, that's the only thing that makes sense to a racist. And it's frighteningly ignorant, but it is what it is.
Well, in a weird way, it's like a normal childish human instinct that goes into, when you cross over into racism, you know, it's like, I'm sure he's protective about himself in every way. And I'm sure every argument with his wife or girlfriend or whatever was also where he was completely right and she was just trying to get one over on him, and, you know.
Totally. Someone asked me in an interview recently, they said, do you think Krauss, it was actually Charlie Rose, said, do you think Krauss thinks he's a racist? And I don't think Krauss would describe himself as a racist. I think Krauss would describe himself as right. Mm-hmm. That's what makes him wrong. And as a result, he is a racist.
Yeah.
The frightening thing about racism and, you know, looking at the behaviors of racists is that they think they're right, and yet their opinions and the way they conduct themselves is informed by a bunch of mistruths about people of color. It's built on a foundation of lies, and they confidently, you know, go about their business and professing their message of white supremacy. But little do they know that historically they've always been the threat. They've always been at fault. And that's there's nothing more horrifying than that, really.
Well, a culture of fear continues to be there, and as we're seeing in our country with Mr. Trump, who's, in a way, you know, often much more subtle. You know, the little things they've been doing in this country with our Justice Department, and, you know, now they're talking about affirmative action for white people, and it's like, you just kind of like, what planet are they on where they, you know, are worried about white people being disempowered too much? It's a very strange...
It's truly frightening. I mean, for him to kind of effectively advocate police brutality and make such an untrue statement, and, you know, I can't quote him directly because I'm not familiar enough with the language he used, but he said something...
You're fortunate.
But he said something to... Well, for the purpose of this conversation, but he said something to the extent of... You know, historically, the rules have been there to protect the criminals for too long, and not law enforcement. And I think, you know, without delving too deeply into that, you know, one thing that this film tries to draw attention to is the fact that historically and systematically, the system has been designed to continually oppress people of color and benefit white people. And so really it's just a different manifestation of that same system. That's what he's promoting. And when he jokingly, you know, advocates, you know, more aggressive use of force, he is encouraging police officers to be more brutal and be more violent. And in the current climate, and given what's happened, you know, in that department, there's nothing more dangerous. I think the encouraging thing to take into account is that many police departments have refuted that plan for a more violent future as far as policing is concerned. I met with James Craig, the chief of police, who's an African-American man and now is the head of the most diverse police department in America. Mm. And from speaking to him and many of his fellow officers, with the highest number of women and people of color in the country, you know, violence and racially motivated police work is not part of their plan. And, you know, irrespective of what their commander in chief, you know, is preaching, they're going to continue in a much more socially responsible, safer, and better way.
Well, it does seem like a lot of the problems that are going on, obviously there is racial issues still going on, but there's also, it seems to be like a degree to which a lack of training and a lack of the idea of what police, the position of police is supposed to be in our country,
right,
has somehow changed, and now, you know, people are shooting people through windows of cars, and, you know, like, the idea of the good old days is kind of this fantasy still, but the idea that, you know, how could any policeman end up shooting somebody who doesn't have a weapon through the window of their cruiser is just, and it's incompetence, you know, and that was a white woman he shot, but in that case, but it's like, it's breathtaking sometimes that the amount of power and the amount of fear gets combined in this way that's just explosive.
Well, yeah, I will say this and prefix it by saying that, you know, I don't know what it is to operate as a member of law enforcement, and, you know, that's a uniquely difficult and complex job, so I don't want to speak for anyone in that respect. Also, my entire opinion on, you know, policing is through the lenses of a, you know, straight white male, so I've never experienced any prejudice in my life, first and foremost, and it's quite possible that I will only ever know, you know, or come into contact with honest and unbiased police officers. I think moving forward, it's important that we have police forces that are representative of the, you know, of the police officers who are representative of the communities that they seek to serve and protect, first and foremost. And when there are cases of police criminality, it's met with conviction. And, you know, police criminality is treated like any other form of criminality. It's something that Laz Alonso's character, Konya, says in the film. And then, of course, what we can't allow for, you know, in between those two things is, you know, more violence and, you know, the mistreatment of suspects or, any, you know, people who come into contact with the police. You know, racially motivated police work just cannot enter the equation.
What's interesting is we also have like the issue of how many rape kits are thrown away in this country.
How many what, sorry?
Rape kits are never processed. I mean, there's all kinds of discrimination that goes on
right
within the system, which is, I mean, I tend to think that any group that feels like they are in threat of losing something tends to react like a group and not necessarily like police or like,
right,
you know, senators or like, you know,
yeah,
doing the right thing. Every group somehow has that defense mechanism. And it's scary. It continues to be scary.
It's truly scary.
I don't think police are bad people. I really don't. I think most of them, I think almost all of them, you know, go in for the right reasons. And but anybody who feels like they're having something taken away, which somehow people have convinced themselves of, a certain number of people have convinced themselves under Trump, you get this reactive thing going on, which is horrifying.
I agree.
And then you get Brexit on top of it.
Well, that's the thing, you know. I mean, yeah, you know, I think... nothing, you know, proves, you know, the fact that a lot of what is, you know, commented on in this movie is a global issue.
Oh, yeah.
By the fact that in our own country we have, you know, racial tensions and we have a fractious relationship with our, you know, police force too. You know, I can't speak for Ireland or Australia or, you know, other places, but, you know, racism, as I said before, as it is a global issue and something that, you know, is only going to be, I don't want to say solved because I don't want to make it that simple, but the opportunity for social justice being a reality for everybody and equality being, you know, achievable is only realistic if, when invited into the conversations about racism and being offered a seat at the table where, you know, everyone is working towards progression and equality, you know, we don't deny that invitation. I think it's important that when white people are encouraged, you know, to get involved, that we accept that invitation and we heap up that opportunity, because for as long as we avoid it, we continue to perpetuate the problem as opposed to be a part of the solution.
Which is interesting, is the British are always... I have 10 more.
No, because we're running late and you're
meeting. At 4:30, yeah.
I'm so sorry.
What time is it, by the way?
It's 4:15.
It's 4:20.
Okay, right. Yeah, I think we are. I think we were all backed up by 15 minutes, weren't we? Yeah, sorry.
Yeah, continue, but I'm just giving you a heads up.
Right.
We're all 25 minutes behind.
Okay, right.
Okay.
sorry about that.
It's okay, not your fault. Anyway, so how about you? How are you? Where are you as an actor these days? Are you feeling ambitious? Are you feeling like your career is in the ascent, or are you just kind of looking for interesting things to do? What is your driver these days?
I feel like I've been really fortunate to, you know, work with people that I've long admired. I've had opportunities, you know, to work with people that I kind of have always dreamt of working with, and you know, didn't know whether certain films that I've been involved with would ever be a reality for me. So for them to come as early as they have in my career, you know, I feel very grateful for that. And I think being part of projects like Detroit has certainly increased my appetite to be part of films that are socially impactful. And I think just as a response to what is going on, you know, from a socio-political standpoint, both in my country and America and, you know, globally, as a creative, I want to try and do things that impact the world in the right way. You know, I think there is a lot to be said for films that are just purely entertaining, you know, and offer people escapism from reality. But I think the most rewarding films to be a part of and the most rewarding films to be, you know, a recipient of are those that make a accurate and impactful comment on the real world. And so those are the movies that I want to be a part of, truthfully.
So are you finding that difficult, or are you finding that, are you material
coming? Are hard to come by.
That's true. There are not many of them.
For sure. Detroit's are hard to come by. But, you know, if every filmmaker was like Catherine Bigelow, I can tell you the world would be a much better place. She said something to Al G. Smith. I think she said something along the lines of, if it's not revolutionary, it doesn't make sense. You know, and can you imagine if everyone had that that opinion? And I think, you know, the tide would be overwhelming for people like Trump if there were, you know, movies that made such powerful comments on society as Detroit does coming out 12 times a year. If there was a Detroit every month,
right,
then I think we'd be, you know, educating the world in a really kind of like really constructive and progressive way. But, you know, various things get in the way of films like Detroit getting made, and you know, other films are given precedence over it, which is a shame. And I don't have the answers as to how to tip that balance, but all I can try and do is be involved as many socially impactful films as I can. And
so, do you have the energy? I want to be. You know, do you want to be a Marvel superhero, or do you care about being a Marvel superhero, or interest in that? Or
with all due respect to those films and the studios involved
and
the people that they hire and Anthony, it's not a goal of mine, and I'm not going to discredit, you know, what those films do. But no, I would you know, reiterate that my ultimate goal is to, I think, be part of films that, you know, have positive social impact. And that's not to say that those films don't, but that's my goal. And also, you know, just personally, I'm also trying to challenge myself and try and demonstrate some versatility and stretch myself, because I think by keeping it interesting for me, I'm hopefully keeping it interesting for audiences.
So do you, if a role is a role being scary or seeming like out of reach or a little beyond your reach, something that compels you?
Is there one?
Well, no. If there was a piece of material and you go, well, that's going to be really hard, I'm not sure if I can quite do that, is that the piece you really want to do?
Yes. Yeah, I think so. I think the role that entices me most, you know, are the ones that, you know, are going to stretch me and push me and force me out of my comfort zone. Those are certainly the films that are most appetizing.
And are you interested in reaching beyond acting, or are you interested in writing or directing or any of that?
Yeah, I do a bit of writing. You know, I've kind of quietly got a little kind of production company, you know, like boiling away on the back hob while I try and sort of focus my efforts on acting. But, you know, I collaborate with a couple of other sort of people in that respect, and it's certainly something that I want to explore, you know, more and further in the future. But right now, you know, I'm just enjoying my responsibilities as an actor. And, you know, after my, you know, commitments to Detroit are kind of relief for me, then I'm going to take a little bit of a break and spend some time with some family and friends and kind of reassess, you know.
So you don't have the actor's fear of not jumping on the next thing immediately? And
I mean, you know, I've certainly been in that place, and I'm not taking anything for granted. I'm certainly not resting on my laurels or expecting that, you know, a wave of opportunity is going to come to me and I can just hand pick. I still think, you know, regardless of where you are in your career, it's important to work as hard as you possibly can. And oh my gosh, I mean, I'm literally just starting out, and I have a lot to learn and a lot of areas where I can improve. But I'm looking forward to taking a break. You know, I feel like I need that for my sanity in order to do the best job possible, whatever the next thing may be.
Have you seen the picture with an audience?
Pardon me?
Have you seen Detroit with an audience?
Yes, I have. I saw it with 2,500 people at the Fox Theater in Detroit, and it was maybe one of the most emotionally affecting experiences of my life. I cried my eyes out.
Because you could feel the room reacting?
Yeah, the room reacted to every gunshot, to every physical blow, to every tear. It was crazy. And, you know, it felt very, very apt that we were, you know, in the home of the story.
And do you watch, are you able to watch the movie, or are you just watching yourself the whole time?
I've watched it three times now, and I can't watch it again. That's it for me. I'm able to kind of step away now. I think the first time you're just kind of, it's a sensory assault. The second time you're able to kind of make peace with your performance and, you know, whatever your mistakes may be. And then third time round, I was able to kind of enjoy the movie for what it was. But a fourth time isn't necessary in my eyes. And I think it's a wonderful film, and I'm immensely proud to be part of it, but it's for other people to enjoy now.
And do you, as you said, you took the cloak of him off immediately. Mm. So it's, you're on to the next thing emotionally that way?
Yeah, totally. I mean, I finished the film a year ago, and certainly not a mindset that I can relate to.
But are you generally of that nature? Do you generally release your character and kind of move on?
Yeah, I think for the most part. I mean, I think the emotional effects of it can sometimes stress me or, you know, cause me discomfort after the fact. But this one's long gone.
And when you hear people talking about awards and things, is that a distraction or?
It's not a distraction. I'm clear in my mind about, you know, why I do what I do. And, you know, if the film gets awards attention, that's a lovely, you know, bonus for the team as a whole. If Detroit can have a real social impact and cause positive change, that's the main award for us.
Thank you so much for your time.
Thanks. Appreciate it. Sorry it was cut short.
It's okay.
Cheers, man. Oh, see, I did a Brendan.